In this learning lab, we're going to be using PI notifications. You're going to notice with notifications, it involves AF. We're going to be using AF as the storage medium for example, the elements that we reference in PI notifications. So we'll create elements, we'll create attributes that point to PI tags. Now there are contacts that need to be created, and then triggers, obviously, for some type of notification. We need a trigger. We have a concept of a contact who signs up for a subscription, so we'll do that. Of course, check everything in to save it, and then start it up and see if it actually works. So that's the goal today. Now, if you are at a point where you would simply like to take a look at the solution, that's no problem. Our Learning Lab environment should have an option here within the AF database to look at the solution. In this case, it's solution_notifications Learning Lab database. So if you just want to open that up and then take a look at notifications, you can take a look at the configuration, etc. from that. Now, I do want to warn you, if you're working on in the online environment, the online learning labs, you will not be able to save your work. Now, you can copy and paste, you can FTP things around, but just remember you won't be able to save. Now, I'm your host today. I'm Nick D'Orazio, and I'm going to start by showing you some slides from our System Manager 2 Advanced Topics class. This is in current incarnation. This is a section on PI notifications. So let's discuss what PI notifications are. Well, the issue really is when you've got so much information, real-time data coming in, you need to take action in some kind of a timely manner. You know, having information doesn't help unless you can take actions and hopefully improve performance and save money. And of course, as the data keeps coming in, you need some mechanism for doing this more or less on an exception basis. You don't want to have to look at everything with your own eyes. You want some type of a notification mechanism to bring your attention to certain things that require further analysis. So that's where PI notifications comes in. Okay. With PI notifications, basically you can do some alerting for anything that looks like it's outside ordinary. It's fairly easy to configure a hierarchy of alerts, and it's not something that requires any programming. Now, we do have extensibility into it. If you are a professional developer or a seasoned developer, I wouldn't recommend it for somebody who's casual programmer, but a seasoned developer can easily create their own delivery channels. So if you want to integrate this with third-party systems, you certainly can do that. And also, we do support notification history within PI notifications. Now, let's take a look briefly at the architecture of PI notifications. Now, PI Notifications is very tightly integrated to PI AF. AF is our asset database that implements a type of an asset-based view of the PI server. So, for example, instead of just searching for tags, using the traditional Rolodex approach where you'd be searching for tag names, instead, using AF, you'd search through a hierarchy. Now, we've implemented notifications such that we attach a notification to specific elements within PI AF, as you're going to see later on. Now, PI AF can reside on its own server. They can be separate from the PI server. And it does integrate nicely. Notifications integrates nicely with some of the other servers that you may have. For example, if you've got a web parts or a SharePoint server that's using our RT web parts, there is a mechanism within notifications that you can configure a notification to have an ad hoc trend that will appear courtesy of what you've done with RT Web Parts, you know, if you've got RT Web Parts installed. Now, in addition, we can, of course, send email. We can allow acknowledgments over the internet. We support delivery channels such as web services and third-party delivery channels. So the notification, I guess I should more draw it like this. The notification involved can basically come from the PI notifications machine out to email or out to out through a web service to another application. Now, in addition, we've got client tools available, both Process Book and Data Link, to take a look at the notifications that are being sent, in addition to standalone applications for taking a look at notifications. So that's roughly the architecture of PI notifications. The basic concept of notifications is that there is some type of a trigger, and that trigger has to be defined, obviously, by the engineer, the user who creates this notification. he specifies, in addition to the trigger, whatever contents he would like to send with that notification. And the contents could simply be a straight message saying, a very simple text message, or it could be something that includes additional information like ad hoc trends or even a file attachment of a trend. And then, in addition, once you've defined a trigger and defined contents, you can specify who gets subscriptions to this. And there's different options within the script in the subscriptions arena where you can, for example, decide how many times you're going to send somebody a notification, whether you keep sending it until they acknowledge or whether acknowledgement is not required, etc. So that's the base concept of a PI notification. To go through the process, I think this is a great way to explain what happens, or to try to explain or understand software. Let's just pretend we're the application for a second. What does the application actually do? Well, the notification service is going to collect inputs, and then it evaluates those inputs against the trigger conditions. If there are any trigger conditions that fire, then at that point, we take a look at the software takes a look at the subscriptions to see if the contacts are available, if the contacts are well configured, the email addresses are valid, etc. Now, once that check is passed, we'll go ahead and add content to this notification, any extra content in addition to just the notification itself, the base message. You can also attach, as I mentioned before, instructions for ad hoc trends, both in or in RT web parts, or do file attachments, for example. And then at that point, once all those three things are actually assembled, that's when we will go out and implement the notification. We will look at the subscriptions and then fulfill those subscriptions via whatever delivery channels have been specified. So the delivery channels are an option that, we have several delivery channels by default, like email and web services, but you can have, in addition, third-party delivery channels. So we'll interrogate, see what delivery channels are required, go ahead and fulfill them. A notification can trigger more than one delivery channel, so you can have things sent to a variety. And then finally, the software is going to be waiting for any kind of acknowledgement from the subscribers. Now, all of this would be kind of meaningless if we didn't describe what type of notifications we support. We support simple comparisons. Temperature greater than 150, pressure greater than this, and we do all the right logical anding and oring you'd associate with that type of a comparison. Now, we also support statistical quality control, or sometimes called statistical process control, SQC or SPC. And as you can see, the standard Western Electric type alarms are supported. You have flexibility of how you define those alarms. And in any event, that's another type of alarm or notification. You can base your notification on simple performance equation syntax. Now, the performance equation syntax that you may be familiar with in PI performance equations is, uses the standard performance equation syntax we've supported for years and years. So any type of existing alert conditions that you've already got within performance equations, you can make use of here. Of course, nice thing about this syntax elements, or these functions, I should say, in performance equations, is you will find functions like things like tag max. And these are functions you're only going to find in performance equations. You don't find stuff like that in Visual Basic or Excel. It's things functions designed specifically for engineering, or people in manufacturing, or folks running real-time processes. So for example, it's looking, in this case, it's going to return the maximum the temperature reached in the last 1 hour. So that's an example of performance equation-based notification. And as you can see, as I mentioned when we talked about comparison, the logical operators AND and OR are available. So that's something you'll see when we get to the user interface for building this trigger. So we support logical ANDs, logical ORs, and what you would expect when making comparisons. Let's take a look now at the actual solution to this. Just to give you an idea of where we're headed with this, we're going to be creating a notification called CDT warnings. Here's a look at the trigger. The trigger is simply looking for a value that's currently greater than 200. And if that triggers, then we will send to people who are on this particular subscription here, we'll send them the content that's defined right here. Now, in order to do that, in order to make this element here, we have to go into AF. This is actually, this trigger is based on AF elements. So you'll notice that part of what we're going to be doing is to go into this elements section and create an attribute that we're making use of in this particular notification. Now the grand finale to all this is that you should be, as this notification works, you should be able to check your work by getting email notifications. Look, for example, in this case, we can take a look here. And using this email address in for the online learning labs, I see that I am receiving a notification. And then in later exercises, we'll add things like instant RT web parts trend, or links, or attachments. So that's where we're going with this particular exercise. Now, as we suggest with just about all of our exercises or our learning labs, if you can, see if you can do this exercise simply looking at the approach. The approach should give you enough information to actually do the lab in its entirety. But in addition to the approach, you know, after you see this stop sign, you'll see there are some step-by-step instructions. So you can always look at that if you get stuck with the approach. But see if you can give the approach a try first.